works with some grain of presence or service. It is a lot of hard to work with some other people. And it's one that is all the difficulty that we have. So, we call it a frame for wisdom to be poured out on the whole world.
Remember the gospel to keep the death of the
We want to continue our series in Philippians today after looking at Philippians chapter 3, verses 17 to 21, talking about being citizens of heaven. Citizens of heaven. A few months ago, in January, set forth the theme for 2020, we call it 2020 citizens. And we said our vision is Lord Christ above all. Little did we know what 2020 would hold. That has been completely different from what everyone anticipated and what everyone expected. But this one reminds me about that vision we had, because I think even though things have gone ways we didn't expect, God still has that goal in mind of Christ above all in our lives. So I want to remind you that we said that our motto this year was magnify Jesus. Magnify Jesus as Lord. And then our objective is to let Christ rule in our lives. Amen. And we said that our goal is to develop habits that allow Jesus to be Lord. Now, even though the coronavirus epidemic, even though we're in a very contentious time, socially, politically, those goals are still good for each and every one of us. Because it's still our God, and we need to develop those habits that allow Him to be our Lord and our God and our God in the new day. So, if we magnify Jesus as Lord, no matter what circumstances are around us. So, I just want to remind you of our 2020 vision, Christ above all. So, let's look at Philippians chapter 3, verses 17 through 21. As we begin this morning, this is continuing Paul's theme of pressing on, reaching towards the goal, a high call of Christ Jesus. And so he goes on in verse 17. Brothers, warning and imitating me, and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example in all directions. For many of whom I have often told you, and now tell you, in your tears, walk with humility. Of the cross of Christ. Their ears are crushed and their bodies are belly, and they glory in their souls, with minds set on earthly things. The earthly is what does not happen. The front that we are ready to save, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body. Our power is an amazing strong even to forget all things. Let's pray again, the Father, as we begin to look at your word this morning. We're just overwhelmed by the concept here that we are citizens of heaven. Oh, we're going to be so glorious. We're going to last in the county, just stay in Florida, in the United States of America, and we're our true citizenship. As Christians, we're citizens of heaven. And so, Lord, we pray that this year will be and bring us to your kingdom. We will represent you by the Jesus' name. Amen. Now, this is an independent weekend, and we celebrated our infant birth on this last quarter. It's today. We will have fireworks and galleries and good food. And hopefully, you had a wonderful time. And your dogs were being frightened by the fireworks going on. And while America has a lot of problems currently, people are protesting to correct those problems, we still have much to be thankful for in the land and our land that promotes life, liberty, and freedom. This is just as the United States of America. There is always the right that few people experience other nations around the world. I'll be here in our church on this week, and we'd be proud of some of it. But if you look at this passage today, the Apostle Paul states that there is nothing greater to Christians in America than even in any other nation
of the Lord. He says that in verse 4 of Philippians 3:20, there are sources of forgiveness and presence, and from that you relate a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And notice he says, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. We are ambassadors for Christ. And this comes in 2 Corinthians 5:20, where the same thing is given about our citizens that we need to be given. We're like ambassadors who are in the embassy in another nation. And if I could have American embassies around the world, we've got a little spot of land in the headquarters, but consider American territory. We as Christians live in this world as ambassadors. We've got a little colony, a little embassy, and we represent our other nation, Savior, Jesus Christ. And we are far from his people. We are his citizens and pastors of Christ. And so we represent the kingdom of heaven. And the question obviously arises today, but how are we to live as citizens of heaven while we reside here on earth? Well, that's what Paul talks about here in Philippians chapter 3, verses 17 to 21. So let's look at what Paul says about being a citizen of heaven while we live here on this earth. First of all, it says, follow those who exemplify Christ. Follow those who exemplify Christ. It's true here that all Christians are on their journey, just like we have listened to those songs that we sang earlier. We are the race aiming for the finish line, the prize of the wages. We talked about last week how the run of the race, they were aiming for the finish line. We're striving to be like Jesus and to be with him forever and ever. That's our goal, that's our purpose. That's what we're striving for and aiming for. And then Paul says, while we're doing that, we need to imitate godly believers who set a good example for us. We're going to need help along the way. People who hear us over and encourage us. And so we need to imitate those who set good examples for us. Notice this in verse 17. It says, brothers, join and imitate me and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us. Paul uses this word, imitate, and the idea behind that is mimic. Mimic. Paul says, look at me, follow my example, mimic what I'm doing. And we're all familiar with the word alignment, and we also see moms as a form before us, and we're pretty close to our ideas here. One way we need to look through the famous modern artist Marcel. One day he taught students how to move with the mind and then to tune in how they might be able to perform locally in one of the theaters. And what they tried to do was to mimic Marcel Marcel as a classic theater in order to master the art of mind. This is a practical picture of what we as Christians are to do. We are to imitate our Lord by being those who have to abide with Christ, but also we're to look at others who have followed Christ's example and set good models for us in our Christian walk. So as we look at them, as we reflect on their actions, then we too can become more like Christ. To live this life the way he wants us to live. And Paul says, look, not only do you need to walk through, set your eyes on those who walk the journey of these things for you and us. Look at others who are in Christian faith. We set examples for you. It might be parents, it might be people who have served, it might be fellow Christians in a Bible study you're with, it might be older people who have gone on before you, followed your life after them. It might be pastors or spiritual leaders whose books and biographies you've read, or you've watched them from afar in the ministry. They're all examples of how you can live a Christian life. also observe them, so they are, so that we can look at it with a goal of visioning to be saved. And so we use the two-return scope, and we don't even know in our lives how we can find out things using that microscope or telescope, how we can see things far with a telescope. Same word Paul uses here, find out, observe, contemplate, consider, and the idea is to come to that word of truth. And so Paul says, look, mimic me. Follow my example and follow the example of others to walk, to live the Christian life. And Paul is, of course, writing here to the people of Philippi, people who knew the first that he had said, and he's telling them, look, he has some good examples there. It's my example, that's Timothy's example, that's Pastor example, that other Christian leaders there in the local church who are good examples. Follow their example and live like Jesus wants us to live. And so, young boy always looked up to his grandfather. One day he asked his grandfather, the grandfather, how do you live for Jesus? The grandfather stood down and looked at the young man and said, that's the one. And here's the ball. Great part of the example of how a person follows Jesus is to have some investment to the world, to the citizens, to be always pointed to Jesus, to God, and to one or the other. As the grandson grew up, he put his eyes on his grandson and began to do things the way he wanted to do things. Certainly began to be the life of his grandson from following Jesus. One day, the young man visited his grandson. Freedom in Christ in order to satisfy the world's personal desires. And this is what people like to do today. Because if you choose to rationalize the sinful lifestyles because you're free in Christ, Paul says, you know what, you're not supposed to be. He says there in verse 18, for many of whom I have often told you and now tell you, teaching with tears, walk the sins of the cross for Christ. These are enemies of Christ, but they're not people who need to lie in the life of Christ. They're setting a long example on their corrupt and deserved. And so we call literally from people in the church of Philippi who are talking like this and reading the others of Scripture. You know, 1520, I said, I was praying in Mexico. And one person who owned that ship passed the wall back. He sold the city there. And so he exposed all the people of this new land to the SEC. As a result, from the small talk that was What he meant by that was that actually the dual citizenship or the life of one country or his citizen, but he also has citizenship in another country, and he might play sports in that country that he no longer lives in. And one of those who was selling a Martin to Bell, he found citizenship because he was born in the United States and he lived here on the father's life. And he attended the University of Florida. And he traveled for competition in the United States. However, he played sports for home. So that's the opposite of his relationship. His father was taken to change the same. He also was taken to when the Olympics came around, he chose to represent the same rather than the United States. That's a picture of who we are. We have this dual citizenship. We're citizens of the world, no matter what nation we live in. Again, we follow the trust of heavenly citizens. And so we have all these rights and privileges at home while living here on this earth. The Paul writes this way, verse 20-21. Our citizenship is in heaven. The Son that we are raised to save you, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body into a glorious body by the power of your enables them even to forget all things to be to the self. Notice the saying that we're citizens of heaven. And this idea that citizenship in heaven is a picture of these Philippians to understand because Philippi is a Roman colony. He was one of the most exclusive Roman colonies. And Marjorie had a headquarters here. And it was a place where a lot of the soldiers that were serving 21 years in the Roman military that were 55 right there in Philippi. And so it's a large population of Roman citizens who lived there in Philippi. And in Philippi, what was many, many miles away from Rome itself. And so the characteristic of the colony was that the citizens were dressed like Romans dressed. The magistrates governed like Roman. The maximum of the spoken language. Roman justice was administered. Roman morals were observed. And then even to the ends of the earth, they remained Roman. Everything was to the table. So Paul says to these Roman colonists that lived in Philippi, it's the same thing we had in the kingdom of God. We're moving to Philippi. And so you need to think, operate, and speak, and act as a world, just like a Christian. And that is what all the world does. And it's like you do as a world of sorts. That's what we're talking about. So we all just do what we can think. But then Paul goes on and says, you know, the cause of that, we look forward to the coming of Jesus Christ as a new heaven. And a new world. It's kind of just a fact that we realize the earth's not it. It's not the final end. But there's a new heaven, a new earth coming. It will be fire because Jesus is coming. It's one of the Father. And he will transform our earthly bodies into immortal bodies fit for eternity. It's fully understood. I know it's amazing. I watched about it first time in 16. But the idea is that one day, into mortal bodies and really changes into immortal bodies. The Bible says we're to live as the people of God. We look forward to the coming of Jesus. And all these things will take place, all these things will happen. Paul writes it this way here in chapter 3, verses 20-21. We all talk about the citizenship of heaven. Most of these things. He will transform our lowly body to be like this glorious body. The power that will transform you to the death of all things to yourself. Jesus is going to transform us. He's going to completely remake us. And so we will wait until we look forward to his coming. And if you are, as he said, this looks forward, it is a rare compound word that's used. Christ calls eagerness the second coming of Christ. That's an idea Your brother, to always abide in the Lord. You know that nothing can be used to you. Thank you. Thank you.